Hot, even as the Fab Four were touring Australia. The remarkable series of hits which followed made Billy Thorpe a major pop idol. By 1966, he even had his own TV show. He reappeared in the early 1970s with the revamped Aztecs. With Thorpey on lead guitar, they played heavy blues-based freeform rock at ear-splitting volume and cultivated a whole new breed of beer-guzzling fans. They were the most talked-about band at the first Sunbury Festival in 1972, and the autobiographical Most People I Know Think That I'm Crazy became a big hit in that year.
In the mid-60s, Australia was in the grip of Easy Fever. A group of boys from Sydney's Villawood migrant hostel shot to fame with their powerful original songs. Centre stage was Little Stevie Wright. The Easy Beat's first number one, She's So Fine, came out in June 1965. A stack of memorable hits followed. In mid-1966, the Easy Beats went to England where they recorded the perfect pop song, Friday On My Mind. As well as going to number one in Australia, the song charted in England and America. It showed Australians they could create world-class pop records and gain overseas recognition. The Easy Beats disbanded in 1969, but Harry Vander and George Young went on to become Australia's most successful producing and songwriting team.
One of the finest and most original Australian bands of the 60s, The Loved Ones began when a group of Melbourne trad jazz players decided to switch to rhythm and blues. With skillful musos and a decidedly mod image, they began to get regular gigs and soon released their first single, called The Loved One. Hastily written the night before they entered the studio, it was a masterpiece of songwriting and musical arrangement. Their next single, Ever Lovin' Man, captured Jerry Humphries' unrestrained, wailing vocals. Nobody sang like this in 1966. A wild, charismatic lead singer, he generated excitement on stage and audiences responded with deafening screams. In 1967, they toured nationally supporting the Animals before the pressures of instant stardom caused them to disband. Although The Loved Ones released only one album and four hit singles, their reputation and influence outlasted their brief time at the top.
In the mid-60s, Normie Rowe was the king. Encouraged by Melbourne DJ Stan the Man Roach, Normie started singing at dances with the Thunderbirds. His first single, It Ain't Necessarily So, went straight to number one. Then his double-sided smash, Hey Sarah Sarah and Shaken All Over, became the biggest-selling Australian single in 1965, staying at number one for a phenomenal 11 weeks. By October that year, Normie had three singles in the top 40 at the same time. His gutsy voice and energetic stage presence produced intense fan hysteria. His concerts were scenes of audience mayhem and screaming girls. In 1967, he was conscripted into the army for 2 years and served in Vietnam. His stint in the army ended his reign as a pop idol. Normie continued to work in music and television, and in 1987 he starred in the popular stage musical Les Miserables. The Twilights were a group of young British migrants living in Adelaide. Their ability to perform Beatles songs complete with perfect harmonies made them popular with local audiences. They moved to Melbourne, the hub of the 60s pop scene, and had their first number one hit with Needle in a Haystack. In 1966, the Twilights won the first Hoadley's National Battle of the Sounds competition. The prize was a trip to England, where they recorded three more hits at Abbey Road and soaked up new influences in music and fashion. When they disbanded in 1969, singer Glenn Shorrock joined Axiom and then went on to extraordinary international success with the Little River Band.
At the end of the 60s, rock music was tripping off the planet into album-based music with long-winded instrumental breaks. But there were still teenagers who preferred to listen to catchy 3-minute pop singles sung by the stars they idolised. Performers like Johnny Farnham, The Zoot, Ronnie Burns and Alison Durbin were good-looking young singers groomed for a mass market. They appeared regularly on Uptight, Ross D. Wiley's Saturday morning television show. Loyalties were splitting, with long-haired progressive rockers looking down on pop-loving teeny boppers. Daddy who? Daddy cool.
In the early 70s, most bands were playing 20-minute guitar solos and taking themselves seriously, when along came Daddy Cool. They were light-hearted, kind of goofy, and they looked a bit weird. From their first gig at the TF Much Ballroom, Daddy Cool quickly became all the rage on the Melbourne dance circuit. They played 3-minute 1950s-style rock and roll songs that you could really bop to. Their smash hit, Eagle Rock, the biggest-selling single of 1971, remains a rock and roll classic. Daddy Who? Daddy Cool, and the first Australian-made album to go number one. Lead singer Ross Wilson went on to produce Skyhook's first three albums. He then formed Mondo Rock in 1976. With his trademark whiskers and distinctive voice, Doug Parkinson has been a force in Australian music since the late 1960s. When his band The Questions visited Melbourne in 1967, they were hailed as the best group to emerge from Sydney in years. Critics raved about Parkinson's ability to sing soul and blues. The band moved to Melbourne and reformed as Doug Parkinson in Focus. Their first single, a version of the Beatles' Dear Prudence, showed off Doug's great voice and raced to the national top five. Then came their classic single, Without You, and in 1969, they won the Hoadley's National Battle of the Sounds. Parkinson appeared in musicals and recorded sporadically over the next few years. He's always maintained his reputation as a solid live performer.
The late 1960s saw the rise of mind-blowing psychedelic rock. Suddenly, bands were creating adventurous, experimental recordings that went beyond the three-minute pop song formula. Russell Morris was a young singer looking for the right song to record his first solo single. The Real Thing, written by Johnny Young, was produced by Ian Molly Meldrum. It used lavish studio effects to create an innovative sound collage that seemed to capture the psychedelic experience. It was a milestone in Australian studio recording and went straight to number one. Russell Morris built on his initial success by writing his own material. Songs like Mr. America and Sweet Sweet Love earned him the award for Best Songwriter at the 1971 King of Pop Awards. His last big hit was Wings of an Eagle in 1972. He then spent time recording and performing in the USA, and by 1978 was back working in Melbourne.
Agga Dagga were and still are the original Australian hard rockers. Bursting onto the pub circuit in the mid-1970s, they went on to unparalleled international success. Forget fads like glam rock, just give me some basic hard rock and roll and a bottle of bourbon. AC/DC's lyrics have a wicked humour which their largely male audience can identify with. Lead singer Bon Scott personified the hard-drinking rocker until his death in 1980. Brian Johnson stepped in and the band released Back in Black, which sold 12 million copies. Angus Young built their sound around bluesy power chords and sizzling guitar solos. Angus is a high-voltage performer who throws himself around the stage like no other. The band's tours continue to sell out stadiums around the world. AC/DC are still Australia's biggest band.
The success of British artists like David Bowie and Gary Glitter, with their outrageous costumes and stage shows, soon led to Australian bands changing out of their jeans and t-shirts into satin and sequins, platform shoes and makeup, and going glam. Hush, Supernaut and Sherbet became stars as their music and their tight lyrics flares were beamed across Australia by TV pop shows like Countdown. William Shakespeare jacked up his platform shoes to dizzying heights while performing bland pop tunes. While Skyhooks added humour and imaginative songs to their bizarre stage outfits. Glam rock with its costumes, sets and theatrics relied on TV to make its mark and to bring sex, fun and sequins back into rock.
John Paul Young was a Countdown favourite. Known to Molly and thousands of Countdown fans as Squeak, his easygoing style appealed to the Countdown audience. Images of girls chasing him around the studio or ripping his shirt off transformed him into an idol almost overnight. Hit singles including Yesterday's Hero and Pasadena, written by Vander and Young, were delivered with a cheeky boyish smile. Songs like Standing in the Rain made JPY one of the few Australians to crack the disco market. Lovers in the Air was revived in the movie Strictly Ballroom. He was a huge star in South Africa, where he toured extensively and caused scenes of hysteria. John Paul Young never seemed to take himself too seriously. He even screamed, "I hate the music," and had a hit.
Australia's undisputed queen of the music charts in the mid-70s was an African-American, Marsha Hines. There had been precious few Indigenous or Black artists based in Australia, and Marsha shone through brightly as a stylish and beautiful pop diva. Her big, soulful voice was in stark contrast to other performers of the 70s. Raised in Boston, where she sang at church socials, Marsha came to Australia to appear in the controversial rock musical Hair, in which most of the cast appeared naked on stage as free-loving hippies. She stayed and was adopted as one of Australia's own. Marsha went on to play Mary Magdalene in the Australian stage production of Jesus Christ Superstar. Her recording career took off in 1975 with Fire and Rain, and she went on to rule the charts over the next 5 years. In the 90s, Marsha's daughter Denny Hines developed her own singing career. In the mid-70s, teenage tastes ruled the charts. Renee Geir, however, achieved mass acceptance while singing blues, soul and funk. Her sophisticated style set her apart from the juvenile antics of her male contemporaries. Her first hit, It's a Man's Man's World, summed up her frustrations. No conventional girl singer, Renee was an independent woman who expected to be taken seriously. After a series of hits, she spent more and more time in Los Angeles recording, performing and doing session work. Renee's gutsy voice has always attracted first-rate musicians, and she recently collaborated with Paul Kelly on her Difficult Woman album. A difficult woman maybe, but there's no denying Renee Geir's great talent.
Sherbet helped put the fizz back into pop, and they looked so good you could almost eat them. Daryl Braithwaite's smooth voice swept young hearts into a sea of pubescent love, launching 1,000 screams on their regular Countdown appearances. Their satin jackets and spunky good looks disguised a hard-working band who toured throughout Australia, taking their music to their legion of teenage fans. Daryl's voice, coupled with Garth Porter's songwriting, created a magic combination that scored a phenomenal 20 hit singles and captured just about every award. Often overlooked as a teeny boppers band, Sherbet had the first ever British top 10 hit that was written, recorded and produced entirely in Australia. How's that?
When the first colour countdown went to air in 1975 and Johnny Farnham introduced the first act, it was a defining moment in Australian rock. The band was called Skyhooks, the song was called Horror Movie, and the impact was spectacular. Skyhooks exploited the theatrics and glitter of glam rock, but gave it humour and wit with an Australian flavour. They were original, flamboyant and impossible to ignore.
You put yourself on a stage, it's absurd not to wear costumes or wear makeup.
Skyhook's songs sounded different, and what's more, the lyrics were actually saying something. They were the first band to be blatantly Australian in their songs. They not only sang about suburbs like Carlton, Toorak and Baldwin, they actually sounded Australian as well. They were provocative, daring, and never took themselves too seriously. It had been a long wait, but rock musicians were finally singing about real life in a way that the audience could relate to.
When pub rock really took off in the late 1970s, one of its leading exponents was the Angels. Originally from Adelaide, they released a mighty first single, Am I Ever Gonna See Your Face Again, in 1976. The Angels developed their own style of tense, hard rock, forged on the powerful guitar riffing of Rick and John Brewster. Lead singer Doc Neeson was a maniac on stage, delivering his vocals with high drama and urgency. By touring constantly, the Angels developed a loyal following in the suburban beer bars. The classic 1978 album